look at this. It doesn't even look like the same country. Even the valleys have changed.
It nothing matches the map.
Where's Spirit Lake? Is that it over there? I can't believe I've camped up in this area. It doesn't look like any place I've ever been before.
This landscape did not exist 50 years ago. This lake is twice the size that it was then, and these rivers follow different courses. This landscape is home to the world's youngest glacier. And while almost all of the world's glaciers have been shrinking, this one has been growing rapidly. It lies deep within the crater of Mount St. Helens, a mountain that used to look like this, until in just a matter of minutes, that changed.
Now we got a big slide coming off. Now we've got an eruption down here.
This is a story about the power of our planet. Its power to destroy, but also to bounce back. Before we get going, I do want to give a quick thank you to my friends over at Envato Elements for sponsoring this video and sponsoring this trip out to beautiful Washington State. Envato Elements is a massive library of stuff, and I say stuff because it's pretty much anything you could possibly ever need to run a creative business. Footage, photos, motion graphics, After Effects templates, all the way down to like Google Docs templates, email templates, WordPress themes. All of that under one very affordable subscription that has you covered for any of your personal and commercial work, with no need to worry about complicated licensing. One area of my work where this comes in particularly handy is when creating motion graphics. I use a ton of like film burns, light leaks, backgrounds, overlays, all throughout my videos. You'll actually see a ton of those in this next first sequence of this video coming up. There are a ton of different subscriptions out there, but what makes Envato Elements unique is that they have so much stuff. I've never come across one that had this many different types of elements available. And the fact that it's all available under one very affordable subscription really sets it apart from anything else out there. So if you want to try it out for yourself, there's a link in the description of this video where you can get a 7-day free trial. Thanks again to Envato Elements for sponsoring this one. And now let's go back about 40 years ago and talk about one of the gnarliest volcanoes out there. These are some old postcards I picked up from between the 1930s and 1970s, and I think they set the scene pretty well. Front and center, you have Mount St. Helens. It's this beautiful cone-shaped mountain covered by glaciers almost 10,000 feet tall. It's nicknamed the Mount Fuji of America. And at its base is Spirit Lake, this picture-perfect spot that was popular for boating, swimming. There were resorts out here, just a great place to bring the family and spend a weekend in the mountains. The mountain pictured here is by all means picture-perfect, but it's also an active volcano. And in 1980, there started to be some warning signs that the clock was ticking. The first was a series of small earthquakes around the mountain, beginning on March 16th. The next day, a crater opened up at the summit, and for 2 months, the earthquakes continued, the crater grew, and a large bulge formed on the side of the mountain. That bulge is called a cryptodome, and it's the result of magma pushing its way into the volcano. On the morning of May 18th, a large earthquake caused that dome to slide away. This was the largest landslide ever recorded, and it triggered this.
We had a major eruption occurring at 8:32 approximately this morning on Mount St. Helens. It does appear that the northwest flank of the mountain seems to be gone. Emergency procedures have been put into effect.
Have a look at these satellite images, and you can see that the eruption wiped out this entire area north of the mountain. Trees were blown down miles away from the volcano, and some areas were buried under up to 600 feet of debris. Remember picture-perfect Spirit Lake? Some of that debris crashed into the lake, causing an 850-foot tsunami and pulling thousands of trees into the lake, which are still floating there today. Ash from the eruption blacked out the sun and fell as far away as the Great Plains, and the sound of the eruption could be heard as far away as San Francisco. By the time it settled down, the eruption of Mount St. Helens had caused over $1 billion in damage and killed 57 people, making it the deadliest and most destructive eruption in U.S. history. Here's where this story takes a turn. Within a matter of weeks, scientists were flocking to the volcano to take samples and observe the aftermath of the eruption. This was the first opportunity to study a large volcanic eruption using modern scientific tools and methods. This wasteland could become a giant laboratory. And it did. In 1982, Congress designated the Mount St. Helens National Volcano Monument. That meant this land was protected for research. Everything was left exactly how it was. And leaving this area alone allowed scientists to study what's called disturbance ecology, how the landscape responds after it's undergone a major change, like a natural disaster. So scientists started watching, and what they saw were things none of them expected.
You look around at like any of these hillsides, and they're just covered with rows on rows of trees that have just been knocked over by this eruption. And as it turns out, those knocked over dead trees are actually really helpful for regrowing the landscape.
Let's go back to those satellite images. Here's the volcano in 1980, right after the eruption. And if I click through year by year, you'll begin to see the green surroundings quickly reclaiming the area.
So all of this, like, blast zone area is protected and hasn't been touched. All the trees were left where they were. But the area just outside of it was quickly replanted. They, you know, took out all those dead trees and put new ones in, because that's what you did. But as the years went on, they started to realize that these dead trees that had been left behind were helping the area.
No one expected the land around St. Helens to bounce back as quickly as it has. By the late 80s, the northern areas of the monument were starting to become green again. And in the late 90s, elk and mountain goats returned to the area. In fact, the elk population got so out of control that scientists started promoting hunting to control it.
Another big discovery was about what are called early seral ecosystems, which are these kind of scrubby, grassy areas with a lot of flowers and bushes. The general consensus was that all land should ideally be forest covered, and that these early seral kind of bushy, scrubby ecosystems were subpar and in the process of developing into that bigger, better forest ecosystem. But since this area had been completely wiped out and was in the process of regrowing, it was mostly covered with this early seral ecosystem. And the surprising result was that these ecosystems in this area actually had way more biodiversity, more insects, more mammals, more birds. And that made this suggestion that maybe healthy forestry isn't just about growing as many trees as quickly as possible. It should also mean taking some time and space to cultivate these younger, scrubbier areas.
And these aren't just cool observations. They have real implications for the way that we interact with the outdoors. Research from this volcano helped to inform the Northwest Forest Plan, which I talk about in another video about old-growth forests. That's like the main document that manages forests out here in the Pacific Northwest. It's really important. In the 40 years since its eruption, Mount St. Helens has become the most studied volcano on Earth. It's fundamentally changed our understanding not only of volcanoes, but of forests, rivers, wildlife. And it's still in the early stages of recovery. This volcano will probably yield many more discoveries down the line. Ironically, Mount St. Helens deciding to erupt has brought us much, much closer to the ground beneath our feet. Standing here and looking up at this gaping, ghostly crater, picturing what it used to be, it's a hard feeling to describe. It's beautiful, it's haunting, it makes your stomach sink, it makes you feel infinitely small, and it serves as a visceral reminder of our planet's power to create, to destroy, and to create again.